All right, welcome everybody to the Bodu podcast. This is episode number 3, and I'm very thankful to have one of my really good friends on, Nikola Krčmarević. Welcome, Nikola.
What's up, Po? How you doing?
Not much, man. Same old me.
Yeah, man. Thanks for having me on the show.
Thank you for coming on.
Hey, man. I gotta tell you before we get started, I'm really impressed with what you're doing here. Your setup here, your dedication, you're actually getting this off the ground, and it's great to be a part of.
Thank you, man. I mean, having your support, as I've mentioned earlier, having your support really does mean a lot, because I think, you know, our relationship that we've had so far in our life, it's one of my closest relationships, and I consider you my best friend. Yeah. And you know, I'm very thankful that you're on my side and that you're supportive and that, you know, you've noticed the hard work that I think I've put in so far.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. I think I am beyond impressed with what you're doing, man. I think you've been talking about this, you know, we've been hearing it. And we've been waiting, right? And I've been waiting for you to actually do it, and you're doing it, you know, and you're doing it like big. You're not just, you know, you got the whole setup. You're kind of being very rigorous about it and trying to put up some good shows. And
thank you.
Not just that, man. I think, you know, listening to your first podcast and kind of putting yourself out there and talking about, how and why you're doing this and what led you to do the podcast, you know, it's very inspiring, you know, to hear that, even though we've been friends, like you said, for a very long time, you know, I feel like I got to know you even more listening to your first podcast.
So. Yeah. I mean, honestly, like some of the things that I've shared, like even my sisters, I think I mentioned like wanting to be a helicopter pilot in there or something like that.
I knew that. I was voting. I was hoping that was going to be the where you end up, but you know, it's cool.
So eventually I can be your helicopter pilot.
Yeah, well, you know, getting some free rides around the world would be nice.
Absolutely, man. But like my sisters didn't know that. So like, I think when Boba, like when she listened to it, she was like, wait, what? Like, yeah, I didn't know that. So I think, you know, just being open and, That's part of it. You got to be honest. You know, once you come on, you can't hold back. Like, I can't be worried about what I'm going to say. You just got to be honest. And that's when that natural conversation happens and just kind of starts flowing.
It's definitely takes a lot of, I think, courage to do. And I think, you know, one thing is to think about what you want to do. And then the big part is actually executing.
Well, I mean, as you've known me for over 20 years, for sure. Yeah. I've had a lot of ideas.
Yeah, man, bold idea, man. That's kind of your thing.
But I never actually I've tried acting upon some, but some, I feel like some were way too far out of my reach.
I don't know, man. I don't know. I think I like it. I love when you dream, man. I love one of my favorite ones was, I think, when you were talking about how, you know, you were annoyed that you couldn't get all the jelly or Nutella out of the jar.
Yeah, that's
and
right.
You were trying to figure out how to not waste the little bit left in the jar, and I was like, that's pretty good.
How can we scoop it up? I think I came up with like a jar that just, when you're done using it, when you scoop everything up out of it, it just pops open in half.
Yeah, that's exactly it. Opens up in half, and you can really kind of.
And then you can grab a piece of bread and just fucking get in there, right?
Yeah, that's exactly.
That's a good one. Yeah, man.
See, I remember that, man. I tell you, you got a bunch of ideas, and you know, some are crazier than others, but you know, they're all good.
But this one, I feel like it's a lot of fun. Yeah. I mean, I recorded an episode with Yovita, and I just felt comfortable talking on the microphone. I mean, like before I actually get on, I feel like a little bit nervous. But then once we start recording and once we start talking, I mean, I just kind of, I enjoy the moment and like the company that I'm with.
Yeah, it's awesome. Well, you know, we do this all the time, just without the mics and the headphones and the cameras and all that stuff.
Right. But so this is a little bit different.
It's a little different, you know, there's going to be a lot of people listening and stuff, but you know, I think, you know, we do this on the day. So why not have a, you know, try to, you know, as you mentioned, try to help people or, you know, open up some doors for you know, our other friends or the mm-hmm. community, really, you know, and kind of get them involved or you know, get them familiar with other people.
Yeah, just hearing each other's stories. I mean, as we talked earlier, I mentioned that, you know, I'm somebody listening to you on the podcast. They may not know you on a personal level, but as soon as they hear your story, there's already that connection there. Even though they don't know you, I feel like that's still some kind of a connection, because now they know of you.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, absolutely.
They know
absolutely.
There's a Nikola Krčmarević that does this and that in our community.
Right.
So.
Right. Yeah. No. That's it's awesome. Like I said, I think, you know, keep it going.
Thank you, man.
Yeah.
But I mentioned in episode one how I came about the idea of, you know, going into medical sales in general. But I mentioned that there was a friend and his wife that helped open up my eyes, and that friend is you.
Yeah, thanks, man. I didn't, you know, I didn't pick up on that when I was listening, but you know, you were telling me a little bit earlier, and yeah, that's true. We were kind of discussing your talents, and it was like, yeah,
possible opportunities. Yeah. You know what I was, because at that point I wanted to do more, but I just didn't know what I wanted to do.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think Clara was the one that mentioned, why don't you try out medical sales, you know?
Yeah.
So that's how that idea came about.
There you go, man.
So, but what I'm trying to say is just having those conversations, those little conversations with people, you know, maybe I would have never thought about going into sales if it wasn't for that conversation.
Yeah.
So
yeah. It's important. It's important to have those open conversations with, you know, with friends. It's kind of easy, right? It's kind of, that's what you do.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, having it on a platform like this, and maybe, you know, people kind of tune in where they might have never taken interest in a subject, and they hear kind of, you know, the story or what, you know, others have done, and, you know, that might inspire them. Or
so with you being on, you know, our friendship goes over 20 years. Mm-hmm. We met in 1998, I believe.
98, I think that's when it was, right? It was, you know, we were both kind of fresh to the US, and I think our parents, right? We, they took the same class, English class.
They did.
Yeah. And, you know, they kind of met each other that way. I think there's a whole story about that.
Right.
We won't bore the listeners, but, yeah, that's, they met, and then we eventually, you know, they became friends and we got introduced, and
yep.
You know.
And it did help out that we were both living in the same town, Berwyn.
Yeah. Yeah. We were both in Berwyn. There was a lot of us.
There was a lot of us.
Yeah.
Your cousin.
Yeah. My cousin Stefan and me, and, you know, Serbo was in the area. You know, so we kind of, I think Dushko and Brana were kind of close by too, or
they were
in the building next door or something.
Exactly. Like they were maybe a couple blocks away from where I lived in Berwyn at the time.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, and it was nice because some people come from Serbia and they come here and they don't have that, you know, opportunity to meet other Serbians in their area.
Yeah.
So luckily for us, we lived in the same city.
Yeah,
and we were able to, I was able to interact with other Serbians.
That's bad. I mean, speaking from experience, right? We're our parents were very kind of protective and wanted to kind of, you know, not control, but, you know, they were really worried about who we hang out with and who we, you know, spend time with. And
right.
I think having, you know, being in Chicago alone is just such a huge Serbian population. And then having to be in a city that there's a lot, you know, I lived next door to me was a Serbian family. And then on the other side of the fence was my cousin, right? So it was like three Serbian households on the same block. And you know, that's kind of, Berwyn had a lot of Serbs.
It did, for sure.
Yeah.
But, you know, with our relationship, with us having that long relationship and me considering you a very good friend, I mean, it's awesome that you're coming on and that yeah. You're supportive. So thank
absolutely.
You for that.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. I think, you know, I, as you mentioned, we talked a little bit earlier, but, you know, we started, you know, hanging out and then eventually led to a lot of soccer.
It did. Right?
So it was good to have, you know, to meet people your age
and then
to be able to, you know, kind of grow that relationship through playing sports. You know, I always remember before I really, I think, got to know you or really met you, I heard it was like, oh, there's this kid that's, he's really good at soccer, you know, and you played with my cousin on the team, and
yeah,
and they were bragging about you, and I was like, all right,
yeah,
let's see what this guy's about.
Too bad nothing came out out of there.
Well, you know, it's life, right?
Yeah, I mean, I feel like everybody's good at something at some point in their mm-hmm. life, and then, you know, life happens and you take a different route. But, you know, I'm not too worried about it, because if I was a soccer player, then I probably wouldn't be a podcaster right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, that's
probably, and I probably and I'm lo- true. I'm loving this right now.
It's great, man. But I would have been fine chilling in Madrid or Barcelona or something. That's true. That would have been nice.
That's true. That's very true. So I really wanted to have you on because I think, I mean, I told this to Jovica too, so I feel like I'm going to be repeating myself, yeah, but I feel
cool.
like...
I didn't listen to your podcast yet.
Okay, good. But I feel like you as well have a lot to offer. So, you know, with the career you're in and how successful you are, I think it's just good for people to hear your story because, you know, it's just going to bring our community a little bit closer together. Yeah, man.
I appreciate it. I'm here to share.
Well, thank you for that, man. Yeah, yeah. I appreciate that. Supportive, very supportive.
Always. I think that's the way. That's the way you should. You need to be supportive of your friends, especially your friends. I think you should be supportive of everybody.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but you know, why not be supportive of the people that you care for?
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I feel the exact same way. But so kind of, I just want to touch a little bit about your career and your education. Absolutely. And how you got to the point where you are at right now in life and kind of the choices that you made to get there. So I guess we'll just start with high school. You know, you went to, I think you went to two high schools.
Yeah, that's true, man. We started with Morton here in Berwyn, and then we moved out to Downers Grove South. So I was Mustang on both teams, which is awesome.
That's true. I didn't even realize that till now. But I love the story of my sister waking you up early to pick you up to go to school.
Oh yeah. That's the best. When we were in high school and I was a freshman and Boba was, I think, a junior and Drago was a senior. They were kind enough to pick up a freshman and drive him to school. But what they didn't tell me is that, you know, Drago's a little bit of a book smart nerd, let's call her. and she had like,
what time were her classes at?
I know she had period, you know, most people, you know, go to school and it's like first period, second period. Draga had period zero.
You know, what time is that?
I don't know, man. It was like 7 o'clock. Her first class started, you know, so she would, you know, Boba and I would drop her off at school and then we would go and like hang out at like Dida and Bida's house. And I would take another hour nap before I had to go to school.
Bro, that sounds miserable. Like having to wake up and then, oh man. But you know, it worked out.
No, it was fun. It was cool.
And then you went to Downers Grove High School after that, right?
Yeah, yeah.
How old were you when, or what grade were you in when you started over there?
Sophomore year.
So you were only just freshman year. At Moyen West.
Yeah, nice. We moved out west, further west, you know. My cousin moved out there. I think Serbo moved out there, and we also moved out there.
Right.
So I was in Downers Grove for the next 3 years, and I mean, kind of leading into how some of those moves kind of influenced kind of where I ended up.
Mm-hmm.
I think while at Downers Grove, I took some classes that were offered there that, you know, were kind of architectural based or CAD or drafting, and
mm-hmm.
kind of, it was nice to have that opportunity to do that at a younger age.
So you got a nice little feel for it right in high school because you were able to take some classes there.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it was one of those things that it was good to even though I almost knew or had an idea what I wanted to do. It was nice to have those classes very early on and in high school and kind of confirm my interest was actually true and, mm-hmm. and I liked doing that and kind of led me to architecture.
What things in life kind of influenced that decision? Like when did you know you wanted to be an architect or you wanted to go into that field?
Oh man, I think, or I didn't know, you know, I kind of knew like subconsciously, you know, I was always two things I think that really led me there was I was always interested in how things came together,
mm-hmm.
you know, and a lot of that was, you know, I was influenced by my dad and my grandpa. You know, they were really, you know, hands-on guys. They
sure.
they did a lot of construction work, you know, as side jobs, you know, especially here in the U.S. They were, you know, doing gutters and windows and stuff like that. And I tagged along from a young age. But even before that, in Serbia, when we were living there, you know, my dad was building his house. And, you know, he would be out on the soccer field across the street. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, it would be time to, you know, the workers would come over to build a house and he would run off the soccer field. And, you know, that's the story I kept hearing. And
right.
then, but I was very similar in the sense that, you know, I was very interested in seeing what the guys were doing rather than, you know, going playing with the rest of the kids, you know, across the street. So I spent a lot of time kind of looking and experiencing that as a young kid.
Uh-huh.
I think that had a lot of influence on me, and I was always interested in like the built environment,
mm-hmm.
you know? And, so that was one. And I think the other one is, you know, which I think I learned way later. I didn't know this going into architecture. You know, you always hear, oh, you draw well, you should be an architect, right? You know, you're good at drawing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or you're good at math, right? Those are the two things that everybody kind of, that doesn't really know or hasn't been a part of the field, kind of that's the assumption, which, you know, those are good things to know or have skills
uh-huh.
in, but it's, I never was a good drawer, you know,
right.
I'm not really good at drawing your picture, but I was good at math. But I think what I've learned later on is it's really not even math. It's problem solving. Like as an architect, you're doing a lot of problem solving.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved it. That was kind of my favorite thing in math was like, you know, solving word problems, you know, finding a bunch of, getting a bunch of information and then working it out.
Right.
And that's really, to me, that's what I understood architecture to be later on when I actually started practicing it.
So what kind of problems in architecture are you running into, or like what kind of problems are you solving?
Well, it's, you know, I guess so many, right? You're starting off with, you know, you're solving your client's problem, right? Your client has, you know, they want to, let's, you know, not that I've designed or built a house, but let's start with a simple kind of example, right? Your client comes to you and wants to build a house.
Right.
So their problem is, I need a house, right? So you take their information, you get to know them, you want to find out what, you know, what they like, how they live their life, right? So you get all this information in, and then you take that information and draw them their dream house.
Right.
Right. So it's really, that's kind of the core of it, like the you know, the very simple version, but every single, then from there, every single detail or every little pencil mark you do,
mm-hmm.
you're kind of evaluating constraints. So like, you know, there's building code, you know, you have to interpret, there's, you know, city requirements, zoning, you know, so there's a lot of input that you're getting, and then you're kind of distilling that information and coming up with a solution.
What a solution, yeah. Yeah. So you went to UIC, right, for architecture school?
Yeah, so, yeah, after you know, I've gotten that a little bit of experience in high school, you know, I've kind of put two and two together, basically, mm-hmm. you know, I like construction, I like the built world, and, you know, took some classes, and I went into college knowing kind of what my degree is, and I know a lot of people aren't kind of blessed with that knowledge or that idea right off the bat going into college.
Mm-hmm.
They go into college to figure out what they want to do. I always kind of knew what I was going to do. So then I looked at schools that offered that program. And I think locally it was Chicago, it was UIC and it was IIT. Those were the two schools that offered architecture.
That was here in Illinois?
In Chicago.
Or Chicago.
In Chicago, yeah. And it was, you know, for me, it was very important at that time and even further in my college career to stay in Chicago, you know.
Yeah.
I moved once already, you know, I did the big move from Serbia to the U.S. that I didn't want to move again.
Right, that makes sense. And leave your family.
Family and friends, you know.
Yeah.
So I didn't want to go away for school.
Yeah.
And at the same time, I didn't want to, you know, I knew what I wanted to do and I kind of understood school as a means to an end. Like you go to school, you get your degree and then you're, you know, you're in the profession.
Right.
And I didn't want to be inefficient. I didn't want to spend a lot of money going to school somewhere else. Right.
So yeah.
And that's one of the reasons I went to UIC rather than IIT. IIT was a, or is a.
Where is IIT? And what is it? What does IIT stand for?
Illinois Institute of Technology.
Gotcha.
So they're on the kind of south side of Chicago, but it's a kind of technical school,
mm-hmm.
and it's, I don't know if they're private or they're not a public. You know, UIC is a public school, so the tuition was lower.
Yeah, at UIC.
At UIC. So IIT was just more expensive. So that was, you know, those are the kind of decisions that I evaluated, you know. And again, you know, kind of looking back, they weren't really the, you know, to me, they made sense. The things I was kind of thinking about, and I probably would make the same decision. But looking back, knowing kind of what architecture is and what kind of things you can do in different schools and all that kind of stuff, I would have had a whole different kind of set of ideas and set of kind of criteria I would have used to evaluate where to go. But because I was, you know, thinking local and thinking, mm-hmm. you know, don't waste a lot of money going to school because you're just going to be done with school and then you're going to go do some work.
Yeah.
You know, that was what drove the...
That kind of narrowed down your options.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, that's smart because... I mean, if you would have went somewhere else, you probably would have been double in debt. Or
oh yeah, I mean, for undergrad, I was able to get out of undergrad without any debt. You know, you get some grants here and there, you get some help.
Yeah.
You know, and I was able to, other than, you know, I did a semester study abroad. That was probably the most money I've spent on a semester. But other than that, I came out no debt.
So getting into UIC, what kind of like GPA did you need to have, or what was the baseline for the application to be considered to the program?
Oh man, now you're making me
think a little bit.
I don't, to be honest, I don't know the exact. It was a, like any other college, it was pretty, you had to have certain criteria, you know. Mm-hmm. it wasn't, you know, the top tier schools. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't Harvard, you know,
right,
Ivy League, but it was, you know, solid state school.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, getting into the school, you know, you had a good grade point average and do well, you know.
Yeah, I mean, you got
on your ACTs and stuff like
yeah.
that. The bigger challenge was getting into the actual school, like the, you know, you get into the university and then you have to get into the college of architecture.
Mm-hmm.
And that was, I think, had a little bit more stringent criteria.
When did you apply for the architecture school? Was it
at the same time?
At the same time.
You can declare basically where you want to go.
Okay, right away.
Yeah.
And that probably saves you time and money as well.
Well, yeah, I mean, again, if you know where you want to go, right? And if you have the credentials, right? The grades,
mm-hmm.
and the scores, you can go straight there. You know, some people have taken the route of, you know, I don't know what I'm doing, so I'm going to go to a university that has a lot of programs.
Yeah.
So they don't apply to, you know, a specific college within the university, and they just go and take some classes and figure it out that way. Other people that, you know, are maybe not, don't have as good grades or haven't, you know, been focused enough in high school, they can take, you know, take some classes right. in community college.
Yeah.
And kind of go that route, transfer in.
Mm-hmm.
There's different ways to get there.
Yeah. So in college, I mean, architecture school is not easy. You probably have to take a bunch of math classes, calculus. See,
there you go. You gotta, absolutely. You do. You have to take calculus. But I did, you know, luckily for me, I was able to take some higher math and physics classes in high school.
Okay.
That got me out of those in the tough university setting.
So did you take calculus in high school?
Yeah, I was able to take AP classes, AP courses
okay.
during my high school years. So I was, you know, as I mentioned earlier, I liked math. I was good at math. So mm-hmm. I excelled it in it a little bit more. And you know, Downers Grove had offered many additional classes if you're kind of excelling through them. So I took calculus in high school and a couple other college math level classes that by the time I think I was a senior in the second semester, I was like in differential equations.
Yeah.
And I looked at the subject and I was like, what am I going to need this for? I looked at the credits I needed in college and it was nowhere near. It was like, you know, only people that go to get a math major need this course.
I see.
I'm not taking this, but I was able to take, you know, AP classes, you know, score high enough to count that as credits
towards your college
in college
degree.
Yeah. So, you know, I remember everybody was like dreading their third year of college because I think the fall semester you would take calculus and then the spring semester you'd take physics on mm-hmm. top of all the architecture classes. Mm. I breezed through it.
Cause you already had it all done.
I had it all done.
So you didn't have to do it.
I didn't have to do any math. I didn't do any other math classes in college. I didn't do any physics classes.
Oh, that's awesome, man. Yeah, so putting in the work in high school.
Yeah, of course.
And doing good in high school and taking AP classes if they're available definitely play out in your favor, you know, if you go to college.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, if you're able to, you know, focus and right. really take advantage of the school, you can credit up quite a few college credits while still in high school.
Mm.
And you know, whether that turns into applying and going to a you know, more prestigious college or university, or you want to, you know, not pay right. college tuition on classes, you know, that's how you do it.
Yeah. Well, it's nice. I mean, you were always focused and I feel like you always knew what you wanted to, well, not what you wanted to do maybe, but like who you wanted to be. And I always know that your work ethic was on point. So like for sure, whenever you did something, you did it to the fullest. Yeah. And I'm sure that was the same in high school with your classes.
Yeah, no, I think, you know, that's, I appreciate you saying that first and thank you. I don't always feel that way. You know, I feel like I could have always done more, focused more, you know, that's kind of my self critique. But, you know, I felt that, you know, school was, me and school agreed, you know, I was good student and you know, school was something I excelled at. So why not, you know, take full advantage of
you
got to go there, you know? Well, I don't know. I wouldn't call it enjoy it. I'd still, you know, rather skip class and go watch, you know, soccer with Serbo.
But you enjoyed learning, you know what I mean? Like, I feel like for example, with classes, with math classes, you enjoyed math. So it's not like you were going in dreading the wrong?
I think it's enjoying is really not the right term, you know, like okay. I think you enjoy things you're good at. Mm-hmm. Right. So if you're good at something, you're more likely to do it. So I was good at math and that's why I like doing it because I was good at it. So why not do it?
So why not do it?
So, you know, for people that are not, you know, finding themselves enjoying doing anything in school, especially.
Yeah.
Now you have to take some classes. I took all the other classes like everybody else, and I didn't enjoy a lot of them. But mm-hmm. I knew that if I do well at them, you know, there's you know, an outcome
for sure
that's favorable.
Yeah. So it's gonna lead you somewhere. You're not just doing well for no reason.
Right. Exactly. So it was, you know, that combined with, you know, actually finding something you're good at or interested in, and then kind of, you know, having that help you get motivated, I think is nice, you know, but not everybody kind of finds that right away.
For sure. I mean, as I mentioned in my first episode, I had no idea what the heck I wanted to do, bro.
Yeah.
And it was confusing, and I mean, it would have been much better to go into college knowing what I wanted to do right away. But, you know, things play out the way they do for I guess, for a reason.
Absolutely. But, you know, I think that's a great way to, you know, you're learning kind of as you go,
mm-hmm.
right? Some of the things that I feel like, you know, I missed out on by knowing what I wanted to do, right? I missed out on the opportunity to gain more. Right, gain more information, more knowledge, diversify a little bit my focus.
Or your understanding or for other...
For other things, right? I mean, one of the things that I always think back, and it's like, I wish I took more classes, or I wish I did a little bit more of, like, when we were in high school, right? Programming and computer science were just kind of hitting the, you know, the kind of more popular mainstream. You know, it wasn't like today, you think like all the kids are like going to learn coding and whatever. But like, I think I took a class and it was like super boring, because it was just like, you know, I don't know. It wasn't, it wasn't interesting. Mm-hmm. But looking back, like, that kind of work, because you find that, like, problem solving and all that kind of stuff in kind of those subjects as well. I can see myself, you know, have gone, you know, I would have maybe gone a different direction if I wasn't so sure that I wanted to do what I wanted to do.
Yeah. Because the things you enjoy in architecture, you probably could have found it in other.
Absolutely.
Like problem solving, as you mentioned earlier. Yeah. So what kind of, I mean, in college at UIC, what kind of GPA did you have to maintain? Or was it just...
Yeah, no, you had to. I mean, to stay in, to stay in the
what program. What was the rock bottom there?
Yeah, to stay in the program, I gotta, you know, don't fact check me, but I think it's like, I think it was like 2.5, you know.
GPA?
GPA. I think it was 2.5. Oh, like, but like, man, it might have been like, you can go below 3,
right?
But like, if you hit 2.5, like, you can't go back, but like, you have to come back. Like, if you go below 3,
there was a minimum.
Absolutely. And then I think the bigger thing was, you know, the higher, you know, you got to look at also, yeah, sure, you can flunk out of school and you got to look at that, but you also lose some benefits of losing kind of a higher GPA. When I went in, I had a really high GPA and I got accepted into what UIC called like the honors program. And this also like this, God, I want to say it's like GG. It was like a guaranteed, professional, spot in the professional program, which meant like, if I just kept up my GPA, I didn't have to apply
to the
architecture master's program. I would have got in because of my high grades and and in the honors college you get some like perks as that as well.
Is that how it played out for you then?
Well, no, I mean I got in that way and I kept it up for like, you know, a semester or two, and then, you know, it was like you got to be above like almost 4, or like you had to be at 4, you know, like on a 4 scale
when you get in,
while you're there.
So you have to maintain
that. You have to maintain like the whole time. And if you drop, you kind of get dropped by that program.
I see. So if you drop out, not drop out, but if you don't maintain that. You get dropped
from that program.
And then you have to reapply.
You have to apply to the actual program later.
I see. Okay.
So I was in that and you know, I let my couple of grades slip here and there, you know, and you know, I got dropped out of that and I was maybe a little careless about it. You know, it was tough.
For sure. You
know,
for sure.
It's not like you can, you know.
Plus, you were still young and, you know, you still wanted to have a social life.
Yeah, I tried to have that balance.
That's important.
Yeah. It would have, you know, to keep up. And this is where I say, you know, I wish I was, you know, I could have done more. But at the same time, I love my life. You know, I was able to manage school and play sports and have friends and go out and travel and do all that stuff. It was just, you know, getting to that level where keeping those grades that high would have really, you would really have to focus a little bit more on that.
What was your least favorite subject in architecture school?
Oh God.
Or what was your hardest one?
Oh man, I don't enjoy writing.
Yeah.
You know, so there was like a thesis or like a architecture writing class or like a history class, and it was like you had to just write about stuff, and I was like, oh man, I don't like writing.
Yeah,
that's not my thing. I'm here, you know.
Right.
Everybody
said
draw. This is where you draw. You don't write.
This is I wasn't expecting this.
Yeah. So that was my.
All right, I can understand that. No. All right. So you went undergrad what 4 years?
4 years.
Mm-hmm. And then you did your master's.
Yeah, so then I did, you know, I felt like as I was, you know, going through the undergrad program, you kind of learn more and what it takes, you mm-hmm. know, to what it takes to be an architect. Mm. And at that time, it was, I think we were just at the end of, you were basically starting to get required in order to get licensed. You have to have a master's degree.
Okay.
And I was graduating from undergrad right around the same time that like the economy crashed in 2008.
Okay.
Right. So I was in undergrad when that mm-hmm. whole housing bubble burst and a lot of people lost their jobs.
Mm-hmm.
So, I stuck in architecture. And then when I was coming out of, you know, in 2010, when I graduated, it was, the job market didn't look that great. And I knew I needed to be,
stand out,
not just that, I needed to have a master's, degree in order to get my license.
Okay.
So I was like, okay, well, there's not a lot of work, you know, a lot of people, you know, take a couple of years off.
Sorry to interrupt you, but so you got your, what was your bachelor's degree called?
Bachelor's of Science in Architecture.
Okay, so what can you do with just that?
You can go work for an architect. You can go work for an architect. And I think prior
to... But you can't get your license.
I think it was just at the tail end of like, you just needed to work. You needed to spend a lot more time in practicing.
Uh-huh.
In order, you know, basically to get licensed, you had to have a certain amount of experience
mm-hmm.
in all these different kind of categories, and you have to pass all these tests. And that's how you get your license. Well, if you have a master's degree, I think that period of time you have to spend in the field was 3 years mm-hmm. to do all this different type of.
So if you have a master's, then it's
only 3 years. I think before they made it mandatory, I think to have a master's,
mm-hmm.
you were able to get your license with 5 years.
Okay.
Of that experience.
I see.
Right. But I think, again, like I said, I think my generation was right at the cusp of those things changing.
Right.
And, you know, I felt like, okay, let's get that master's degree right off the bat.
Yeah.
You know, so like I said, because I was like, I don't know if I'm going to get a job because there's nobody's working.
Might as well just.
So stick to
school.
And
you went straight into it, right? You didn't take a break.
No, I just applied.
I feel like a lot of people make that mistake where they're like, all right, I'm going to take a year break.
Yeah, well, I think if the break is...
Really a year, but some people extend it to like 2-3.
If you're going to take a break to go party in Europe, you know, are you coming back to school? I don't know.
Right.
Maybe. But if you're taking a year break to go work and kind of get some experience and figure out if this is what you want to do, you know, do you want to get further education? Is this, you know, do you like the field of architecture, right?
Yeah.
Then go for it. Take the year break, find that out, you know.
But right.
It's always harder to go back to school, especially once you start getting like a paycheck that's more than, you know, whatever the minimum wage is and working at a retail or, you know, McDonald's or something. So it was nice to, it's always like hard to go back from, okay, now I'm doing what I just studied
mm-hmm.
and I'm getting paid for it, you know, giving that up to go back to school. I feel like it's hard, but.
No, definitely. I mean, you fall out of that rhythm or that groove, like studying and being prepared and just what it takes to get good grades. You kind of fall out of that after that year. And it's just like, oh man, I got to go back to school now.
You got to go back to school.
I just got a taste of the real life for a year.
Yeah, yeah.
Income coming in, traveling, doing whatever I want.
Yeah.
Now I got to go back to school.
Want to go back to school comes like way later.
Yeah.
You know, like now I'm like, oh man, you know, I just gotta like go back to school. You know,
you didn't get enough of math.
No, not enough.
That's a good one. What would you do right now?
Business.
Yeah. I see. Okay.
Well, you get. I mean, my path kind of took me a little bit different route, and you know, I think business school, especially when you stay, if you want to stay in the kind of corporate world, mm-hmm. it means a lot.
Yeah, that's not a bad idea.
Yeah, but at the same time, like I feel like you can also, you learn that by experience as well. So.
Yeah.
And going back to school with a, you know, with a 2-year-old kid running around
is kind of tough.
Not ideal.
Having to study and hold your child at the same time. Oh, man. But you did mention that it was pretty tough too for people who get jobs in 2008 because of you know, if everything with the economy and everything else that was going on. So when you were done with your master's, mm-hmm. was it hard for you to get a job, or how was that process?
It turns out I was wrong. You know, okay. getting a job after I finished undergrad was a lot easier than I thought. And that's mainly because, you know, I had a good relationship with one of my professors, and I, you know, as we talked earlier, I always, you know, made sure I gave my best efforts while at school. So, you know, I think I proved my worth while in school. And one of my professors, when I was finishing grad, when I was finishing undergrad, and I was kind of applying for different grad schools, mm-hmm. She was pushing for me to go actually not continue my education at UIC. She wanted me to broaden my horizon, you know, go to a different school, get a different taste of schooling. And I applied to a couple of different schools, but one of them was UCLA, mm-hmm. which still has a really good architecture program. I think top 10 in mm-hmm. the nation or something like that. And I ended up getting in.
Nice.
You know, and it was, you know, I got into UCLA, I got into UIC. So then I did the evaluating, right, of what to do. Long story short, and you know, we can maybe jump into that a little bit later, but the professor that was pushing me to go to UCLA, she's like, well, you know, I'll get you a job. She worked at Gensler, mm-hmm. which is, you know, the largest architecture firm in the world. So they have like 50 offices and a lot of employees all over the world.
So when she said that, I bet that was probably like, oh,
well, yeah, that's, I mean, awesome. That it was. And she's like, you know, I'll go to LA, I'll get you a job at UCLA, at the LA office of Gensler. And I think, you know, that was like, okay, well, you know, now there's more motive, because one of the long story is, you know, when I was evaluating what to do, again, it was do I want to move, right? Uh-huh. Was that one big move to the US enough? You know, do I want to move
again?
Yeah. Again, right? Do I want to leave a city that's really, you know, Chicago has a lot of opportunities. I want to leave and go to LA. Well, mm-hmm. okay, LA probably has a lot of opportunities. Do I want to go to West Coast? Be really far away from, you know, at the time, you know, we were going to Serbia every summer for like 3 months, and yeah. It's like, felt much further.
Right.
So all those things I was evaluating. And I think one of the biggest things, right, or it was, you know, the UCLA program was 3 years. UIC was 2 years, because it was, they were both 3 years, but I got into the second year of the program at UIC. At UCLA, I would have to go all 3 years. And then on top of that, it was out of state LA tuition. And that was, you know, kind of crazy.
Tuition plus the dorming.
The dorming, the living, housing. All that kind of stuff, right? Yeah. So I was like doing the math, and, you know, it was like, I think like $30,000 for 2 years at UIC,
uh-huh.
or $150,000 for 3 years. At
so $120,000 difference.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I mean, I'm glad you were smart to realize the better option was UIC.
Yeah, I think, you know, it was that, you know, and that's where, you know, she pushed, I'll get you a job there, and, you know, I was like, right. Okay, well, you know, that's gonna help a little bit, which it would have, obviously, but I think in the end, I was also kind of thinking what I want to do later on. You know, mm-hmm. and do I need that? Do I need the schooling? Do I need that degree from UCLA, or, you know, UIC had a great program too.
Yeah.
You know, and was it worth that 120? You know, you're never going to know, because you took one path rather than the other.
But the only thing that you might have had, well, actually, I don't know, because I have no idea.
Well, let me hear it.
but I'm going to state my opinion. Maybe you would have had more networking at UCLA.
Yeah.
Maybe,
yeah.
You know.
100%. That's, you know, again.
Some more connections.
That's hindsight, again. Right. What I didn't realize at the time when I was in school. The big part of school, big part of, you know, especially professional, you know, the professional degree of the master's degree,
mm-hmm.
is the networking, is the, you know, getting to know all these other people that are in the field.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's absolutely, you know, it would have been a different network of people.
But then again, is it worth $120,000? You know,
to somebody at that, you know, a young kid. Yeah. Was like, no, you know, I don't think so.
Yeah. You know, I mean, plan. Judging the way everything turned out, it probably wasn't worth it.
Yeah. I mean, again, if I maybe wanted to go into more of a academia or more, mm-hmm. more really, and even at that time, I knew I was going to go into architecture, but I didn't want to stick to architecture the rest of my life. You know, if I was more of a kind of hardcore architect, designer, you know, it probably would have been a little better for me. Like, I would have had that exposure and then that kind of work, but I knew I didn't want to kind of do that my whole life.
So when did you know that you didn't want to be an architect forever? Or like, did you have that plan before you even went into architecture school?
I don't think I had that plan.
Like, when did you realize that there's more besides just being an architect?
When my first day of class freshman year, when I think one of my professors, he was Serbian actually, said,
what was his name, do you remember?
Oh my god, you put me on the spot.
It's all good, no worries.
I do remember his name, and he's a practicing architect.
Didn't he play volleyball with us once?
He might have. Oh my god. I will come back and I apologize.
You're good, bro.
Not to you, but to him.
Oh, okay. All right.
I don't know, he might be listening.
No, that's true. You got a good point.
Yeah, so anyway, he said, I remember what he said, is if you're looking to make money, you know, architecture is a bad degree. You know, he said, architects don't get paid a lot. And I was like, well, wait, what? I didn't sign up for that.
Wrong person to say it to.
Yeah, man. I was like, you know, my parents have been telling me my whole life that, you know, the way to make money is to go to school.
Right.
You know, which is.
So what did he tell you?
No, he said, you know, he just said it's going to be long hours, a lot of work, and, you know, you might not get the credit and the money for it, you know. And again, it's not really, that would kind of open my eyes to, like, really, why?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then it was at that time that you start kind of, I didn't think of it that same moment, but I was kind of joking, but, you know, you start thinking about, you know, why? Why don't architects make money? You know, I don't want to be a starving artist, you know, for the rest of my life. And, you know, some architects do make good money, and, you know, you work your way up and you eventually get, you know, there's a lot of passion, you know, that you have for architecture, and that's kind of one of the reasons why architects get underpaid, because they're working for, you know, more passionate. So, you know, there's that. And then, you know, that was kind of one of the reasons, but not really the main reason. It was later on when I was actually in the field. Okay. Because then you're really working with, you're really understanding what architecture is. When you're in school, you're designing stuff, right? Your professor assigns you a project, and then you spend a whole year working through it. Professor, you get feedback from professors, from visiting, you know, kind of visiting professors, visiting critiquers, and that kind of stuff, right? So that's the feedback. It's not until you actually start practicing and working for somebody that you understand that there's a client. There's actually somebody that needs, that is hiring you to do a professional service for them, right? There's a business of architecture, not just draw pretty pictures and build you know, good looking buildings. And when I really kind of understood that and saw, you know, what it means to work for someone, right? You're in the service industry, you're working, somebody's paying you to do something for them, to provide a service. And no matter how good you are, or, you know, you're always selling them on what they should be doing.
Mm-hmm.
But in the end, they're making a decision. You know, they are the ones, they're fronting the money. They're, you know, they have a vision. They have the bigger vision. And it's really, you know, architecture is just a piece of that vision, you know. And I was very kind of, I wanted to go broader. You know, even in architecture, I was never like, this is what I want to do in architecture. I want to do single family homes, or I want to do this, I want to do that. I was like, I want to do everything. So I was always like wanting to learn more. I wanted to understand more.
Yeah.
So when I found out that, you know, architecture is just like this little piece of the big puzzle, I was like, well, I want to be in charge of the puzzle, you know? So that's kind of what led me out of it. You know,
that's so you, man. It's like, I don't want this little piece. I want to be I want to be in charge of the whole puzzle.
Yeah, I do. I do.
That's
know?
Awesome.
That's what it is, right?
That's awesome because you're motivated and you know.
Yeah. And then, you know, you learn that, you know, you're just, it's a bigger problem. Right?
Yeah.
You're solving, you know, it goes back to my need or my obsession with kind of solving problems.
Right.
As when you're on the development side, on the owner side of the project, you get to solve all the, you don't get to solve the tiny details, even though you could, right? You can insert yourself into any little kind of level of detail you want.
Mm-hmm.
But mostly you are kind of, you know, looking at the bigger picture and you're solving the big problem, right?
Yeah.
And that was way more interesting to me than just focusing on the little, the architecture piece of it.
Yeah.
Which is a big part, but it's still a part.
Right. And I mean, I can definitely see your point of view on that. The bigger the puzzle, the whole puzzle always seems more interesting. And
well, you get more information.
More information, there's more gears
going,
you know, versus just architecture. It's just architecture. But so right now, what position do you hold right now? Are you at where you want to be? Or are you never going to be there?
I don't know, man.
I never want to be where, you know. You never want to put a limit on something.
Yeah, you don't. Yeah. You know, you always kind of want to continue improving and doing things that are more challenging and interest you or challenge you more. Right?
Yeah.
So, I'm going there, right? I'm in the direction of where I want to go,
mm-hmm.
right? And I guess my title is development manager. So like, managing the entire development.
So you got the whole puzzle or what?
Well, you know, actually now, you know, my bosses, right? The owners of the companies have the whole puzzle, right?
But yeah.
You're helping them, you know, you have the, you know, depending on what project you do or what kind of project you're working on,
mm-hmm.
you get a lot more of that puzzle. And now it's more of, you know, you're talking to the architects up front. You're kind of leading the design or the program or whatever. You're making the decisions on what to do based mm-hmm. on, you know, their suggestions and so forth. And then you're, you know, executing on that. You go into construction. Then you're working with contractors.
So you deal with every piece.
You deal with every piece. You know, you're talking, you know, whether you're doing a project that's a rental, right? Multi-unit,
mm-hmm.
Multi-family, rental project. You're talking to the leasing people, right? You're talking to the operations people. You're talking to the designers, to the architects, mm-hmm. to the contractors, right? And kind of throughout the life cycle of the project, from start when you start the planning, all the way down to when you're finishing, and then you're, you know, getting the leasing team in, you're moving the residents in, you're kind of setting up the operations, you know, you're kind of involved in that whole thing.
In the whole thing.
And then you learn that whole process and then you start it over again, right, on a different building. And you kind of, you get that experience over and over again.
So how long after you started working as an architect, how long after that did you have this new role as a developer, right?
Well, I was 5 years total. In architecture. So I was, you know, I started in 2010.
So 5 years, including the 3 years for your master's program, right?
No, to 2 years. Yeah. Yeah. So I started in 10 and I was doing kind of part-time while going to my master's.
Mm.
So I was ended up, I don't know if I finished the story, but instead of going to LA and working at Gensler, I actually got a job at Gensler, Chicago.
Okay.
So I ended up going to work at Gensler. Thanks to my professor.
Mm-hmm.
And I stayed there during the time, 2 years that I was doing the master's program. I was kind of working part time. And then I continued into an actual, you know, full time hire. And I was there for 3 years, full time.
Okay.
And that whole time, you know, I was like, okay, what's next? Right. Like, well, not what's next as in, kind of, I'm going to development. It was like, okay, now I'm out of school. What's next? Next is get my license.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, I did all this, you know, 4 plus 2, 6 years of school. but without a license, I'm not technically, like, you know, the first day you're like, you get your titles and stuff, and you're like, oh, you can't, you're not an architect. You can't be called an architect. You're not only licensed.
Right.
Architects can be called architects. So I was like, wait, I went to 6 years of school
for not to be called an architect.
Oh God. Okay, fine. What's next? Right.
Yeah.
So you go and, you know, I tried to do that as fast as I could. Right. It was basically my timeline was, or the two things I had to do was have the experience, which was 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
And that's pretty much, like, you can't really speed up time.
Right.
You can slightly, actually, because if you work overtime, you have more hours. So it's 3 years worth of hours.
Mm.
And everybody knows architects work like 80 hours a week.
Right.
So I could do it in a year and a half if I really wanted to.
Yeah.
But I, you know, I took the 3 years and I, you know, focused, made sure I hit all those experience markers that I needed to.
Mm-hmm.
I had really good, like, mentors and people in architecture that allowed me the opportunities to hit all of the specific areas of experience. And at the same time, you have to pass, at that time it was 7 tests. State tests, you know.
Seven. To get your license.
To get my license. So.
Were they hard or what?
Yeah.
All every single one, or was it like, I mean, the seventh was the hardest?
No. The ones that I took before going to Ibiza were the hardest because I was focused on.
You were focused on Ibiza.
Yeah, those are the two. Those are the two I failed.
That was a good time we had there.
Oh yeah, man. Yeah. So
we're gonna have to go back once.
Oh, yeah.
But that's a subject for another.
Yeah, we'll do another
for
we'll
another episode.
Talk. Yeah.
Okay.
But yeah, no, I was, they were tough. They were, you know, they're made to be tough. They're made to be, you know, to make sure you know the subject. They were a little, sometimes unnecessarily tough, right? Just kind of confusing.
Yeah.
But you know, you sit there, you have a big book of things to study and, you know, I focused on it, right? I did some studying,
right?
You know, I was always good at school and good at taking tests, so I wasn't really too nervous about it. Put my time in, and I, you know, I started it. You know, you hear kind of timelines, right? Some people, you can do it as quick as in, you know, 7 days if you want to take a test a day and you want to study for all of it. But that's like, you're crazy,
right?
So, you know, people say like a pace of kind of once a month, you know, one test a month, is probably a good pace. So I was like, okay. I'll shoot for that.
Yeah.
But I started a year ahead of, you know, having my, I think it was a year ahead of, like, I knew I was going to complete my hours at the end of the year.
Okay.
So I started studying and taking tests at the beginning of the year.
So you're ready for it.
So I was like, I'm going to finish the tests and then I'm just going to wait for my hours to come.
And then as soon as.
And then I'm done. Then I have my license. Right.
Oh, so you were able to take your tests before you do the hours.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. You can take the test right out of school if you wanted to.
Yeah.
So, you know, I did that and I think it was like, you know, I started studying in like February or March, I think, of that year. I think it was almost a year.
Okay.
And then I, you know, I took a couple, did good on the first couple, I think, 1, 2, I passed it. And then I, like I said, summer came, right? So I wasn't as focused and I failed. I think it was like either right before we went on vacation or right after. You know, like,
you
was,
beat some, man.
Yeah, I know, right? And I was like, I was elsewhere, missed those two.
Yeah.
And then I continued taking the rest and I, you know, and it was like one of those things where if you fail, you can't retake the test for like, I think either three or 6 months. No, it wasn't six. It was like 3 months, I think.
Yeah.
So like,
so you didn't want to fail.
So it was like, you don't want to fail because it just keeps extending your time. So I failed the two. And I was like, okay, now these I can't take until like November. So I'm going to take as many as I can.
So there was no order. You didn't have, you could have taken the seventh before you took the first.
Yeah. They were all different subjects, different things.
Well, that's good at least.
Yeah, no, it was good. So you know, I had
you
other
fail
ones.
One, then you can focus
on another one.
Right. Instead of just waiting for the time to pass. Yeah.
So it was good. I got all that done by the end of the year. I think I literally took my last test like, you know, end of December.
Was there a certain amount of tries that you had?
No.
So you can
You just have to wait. You have to wait that period. If you fail, you have to wait that period. And you got to pay the money. They cost money.
How much is each test?
Oh, man, I want to say like a couple $100.
So you don't want to fail.
No, you don't want to fail. And my work covered, they would pay for the test if you passed it.
Yeah.
So you're like extra motivated. You're like, okay, they're going to pay for the test. I'm going to pass it.
You know, right. Right.
Keep going. So the two that I failed, I was like, oh, damn. You know?
So then.
Yeah. So then I, you know, an opportunity came.
Yeah. How did that opportunity come?
You know, I was just open about what I wanted to do.
Yeah.
You know, and kind of talking to people, networking with people. I was, you know, didn't necessarily want to or need to make that transition that quick.
Yeah.
That was never really my intention. But being open about what I wanted to do, like an opportunity came, a colleague of mine and, you know, her husband made kind of a similar transition from an architecture to a developer. And I had a conversation with him and, you know, he's like, you should come work for us. And did a couple of interviews and got hired.
Nice.
And,
nice.
You know.
So it all comes down to networking, and I mean, not all doesn't all come down to networking, but it's an important part of opening up doors and to Absolutely. Other opportunities.
I think, you know, it's networking, right? It's hard work. I think hard work. You got to no matter how well you're networked, if you really don't have something to show,
right?
If you're not good at what you do or you know, work hard, that's, I think, come hand in hand. If you work hard, you're going to be good at something.
Yes.
And then, you know, having that, you know, opening up to people about what you want to do and kind of expressing. I think we always talk about, you know, visualizing and talking about your goals and what you want to do, you know, and part of that is expressing those, right? So like you did with the podcast, right? You weren't keeping this to yourself the whole time, right? You kept talking about it and wanting to do it, you know.
I think it was important for me to share that idea with family and close friends, because if they weren't supportive or if they didn't see, you know, my idea of this podcast as being a good idea, you know, if you guys came out and you're like, I don't know, you're wasting your, you know, why would you waste your time with something like this? Then I probably would have never done it.
Yeah, you do, and it's, you know, it's, a lot of people have different, you know, opinions. And especially, I mean, you're sharing with, you know, people that you know are going to respect you enough to tell you the truth.
The truth. I don't want sugar-coated opinions.
Yeah, right.
I want the truth.
Absolutely. And you, and it's not just, you know, you want the truth and you want support.
Right.
If you feel that that's, you know, the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
But I think even, you know, professionally, I think you gotta kind of be your own advocate. Right, you wanna push for what you wanna do. Right, you wanna say what you wanna do. You wanna kind of push your bosses and your work,
mm-hmm.
And not be content with, like, unless you want to. I mean, shit. Some people just are content with what they're doing, which is fine. But right. if you're really kind of pushing, you know, you haven't really either found what you want or want to do more or want to take on more, you know. It's very rare that people will just give you something.
Right. You have to be out there.
You have to let them know that you want it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, one way is by putting in the work.
Right.
Like, that's, I think, the best way. But then also telling them that you
So, want. I mean, that's an excellent point, because I'm a firm believer that you have to be able to be comfortable speaking up.
If you don't believe in what you're, you know, selling,
right,
what you're talking about, what your opinion is, you know, if you're not confident enough to speak up about it,
right,
who else is going to believe you?
Exactly.
You know, so, you know, I think you have to, right? You have to, especially, you know, professional world, right? You want to kind of set yourself within the environment where, you know, the people you're working with are willing to listen and hear you.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's also very important, you know, and I was lucky enough through my career to have people that were willing to listen and hear me.
Right.
Right.
But it's not like they were just listening to anybody. What, you know, whatever you were saying and your opinions, they had value.
Right. Well, yeah. And
which is why, you know, which is why you're at where you are and which is why you've had the success. I mean, which it's not the only reason, but you get what I'm saying.
No,
it's part of it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, you have to, you know, you have to prove yourself,
mm-hmm.
of being, you know, worthy of an opinion,
right?
Right, for you to be considered seriously, And you know, the way you do that again is you put in the hard work, you mm-hmm. put in the hours, you take the initiative, you go a step further than most people are willing to.
Yeah.
And that's really how you prove yourself.
Yeah. What was the first big project that you worked on? Or when you got your job as a developer, what was the first project you took on?
Yeah, so I took on a few projects. I mean, when I went into development, the first firm I worked for,
mm-hmm.
we did a lot of student housing projects throughout, you know, through the nation.
Yeah, I remember you building like college dorms, right?
It was privately owned college, basically apartments geared towards college students.
Okay.
So it wasn't really a dorm in a sense that it was associated, you know, the university didn't own mm-hmm. them. So the company I worked for owned them, leased them, did all that kind of stuff. And we built them like right next door to the university, right? So like right across the street from university land, you find some property and
yeah.
build a building. And
I bet that was probably a cool, fun little project because you were of that age right out of college. So it's like, you know, you're building this building, picturing yourself going there, right? Or staying there to go to college there. So it's like you're putting these little details and these little yeah. things that you would want.
Oh my God.
There.
Oh my God.
While you were living there. You know what I mean?
I wish. Right. Oh my God. We were building these things. I mean, in the 3 years that I worked there, I worked on six or seven different buildings, different projects in seven different towns in the U.S. all the way from like Florida, Gainesville and Tallahassee, Florida to like Boise, Idaho, Boise, Kansas,
mm-hmm.
Missouri. So like I went to all these schools, right? Right. And it was back to my original where I was like, oh, I'm staying in Chicago, you know? So I finally got to live my, you know, life in a university town.
Right.
And boy, did I spend a lot of time there. but it was, God, I wish I had the opportunity to live in these places. Because you're right. You're like sitting there, you're like, you know, and I remember we would have like these meetings, internal like meetings, or like, okay, we just delivered, you know, the year that year's projects, right? Mm-hmm. So all of us get together and we were talking about how, you know, what's the cool new thing, right? What are kids these days gonna love and enjoy in these buildings, right? And we're yeah. talking about like arcades and, you know, putting in all these like game rooms and all this kind of stuff. And then we went and built them.
Right.
Then we went and like, you know, put basketball courts in buildings and pools and, you know, gyms that were like rival any other, you know, any health club. Right. And we would just build these things for these kids to, you know, enjoy while they're going to school. You're like, oh my God, I wish I went to this school or lived in this building. Wow.
Yeah. That's cool. 'Cause you were able to put your, I guess what you would like to have, you were able to do that with the building.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it was definitely, you know, it was definitely like interesting and creative to be like, yeah, you know. I would enjoy this.
Yeah,
let's do it. Let's see how we can make this happen.
What other projects did you have that you really enjoyed working on, or what's your biggest project that you've had so far?
So right, still working on it. Yeah, man. The last 4 years of my life were dedicated to this. I'm working on the Tribune Tower redevelopment.
Okay.
So downtown, right on the river, Michigan Avenue, where right? Tribune Tower, 100-year-old historic building.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Man. How's that? I mean, you said 4 years you've been working on it?
4 years. 4 years. So I went from, you know, the company that I, CA Ventures, mm-hmm. which is the company where I built student housing. And then I went to work for Golub and Company and, you know, work on the Tribune Tower for that reason. Right. So we were... You know, when I was applying or thinking about leaving, you know, what my next step is, you know, this project just came out of nowhere. I was like, wow. The 3 years while I was at CA, I was working all over the country, right? And never built anything in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, building something in Chicago right on Michigan Avenue, like a historic building. I'm going to, you know, my name's going to be, you know, next to that forever, you know, not literally, but like I could say that, hey, I've,
I mean, you can pull up the records and I'm sure you would find your name somewhere,
but you know, I would say I worked on that. Right. And yeah, it's been quite a journey. You know, we've been basically my company in partnership with another company bought the building.
So what was the building before you guys bought it?
It was the Tribune newspaper, right? So the Tribune newspaper offices, right? So it was built in 19, it was actually, it's five different buildings all in one, right? Mm-hmm. Together, it's a complex, but it was like, it started with the printing building from 1920s. And then the main building, the tower, which was like this big, at the time, 1924, a big competition, architecture competition, big deal.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it housed the Tribune newspaper company for 100 years.
Yeah.
Until we bought it. You know, and they were starting, you know, the building being 100 years old, it was kind of getting outdated on the office front, right? There's a lot newer, cooler, bigger, you know, different kind of work environment buildings downtown, and it didn't really fit for them.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when my company bought it, you know, they were like looking at a few things to do with it, but it always made sense to be condos, luxury condos.
What other options were they considering?
I think, you know, they were looking at putting up a hotel, you know. Well, I think one was like turn it back into office, just, you know, make it better, more up to today's standards.
Yeah.
It was like hotels, apartments, like any kind of, you know, they were looking at all different options and, you know, landed at luxury condos.
Okay.
So we turned up the whole building.
From bottom to top, they're all condos?
Yeah, it's 162 luxury condos in the whole building with like, you know, 50,000+ of amenities.
Mm. Just, did you guys gut the whole thing and then pretty much?
Yeah, man. We went to town. You know, we gutted everything on the inside. Took a bunch of, you know, floors out, took a good portion of the building that you can't see from the street.
Yeah.
But like took it out and then like built four more stories in another part of the building. And, you know, made it, you know, go from an office to a residential. But a lot of different things kind of were thought about and worked through, but everything in there except, so the building is a national landmark.
Okay.
So you can't really do anything to change the exterior of the building, especially the tower itself.
Mm-hmm.
So like we couldn't touch any of it and we didn't want to.
Right. It's beautiful. Like,
it's beautiful. It's a great looking building. And then the buildings around it were kind of in the historic zone. So it was, we could have demolished them or did something to them.
Uh-huh.
But you were like, no, this is, as a complex, is great. So like we didn't really do anything from, you go there and, you know, when you've probably seen it 5 years ago,
mm-hmm.
you might not notice all the differences. There's a bunch of differences, but it's not, you know,
from the outside, right?
From the outside.
Yeah.
Right. We did some, you know, made a lot of retail on the ground floor, you know, blew out some floors,
mm-hmm.
made it tall spaces. but most of the work was like inside, right? So we created this courtyard and then gutted everything on the inside, just kept the floors.
Yeah.
Changed all the windows, changed all the elevators, changed all the stairs, you know, everything.
I mean, I remember when you took us up there to the Tribune Tower and what was that, like 4 or 5 years ago?
Yeah. It was like 40. Right when we started. We
right when you guys started.
Gutted everything, yeah.
It was pretty awesome, man. You took us all the way to the top and to the balcony of the top of the building, which was pretty cool.
Yeah.
So that whole thing is pretty much somebody's condo or penthouse up there, right?
Yeah.
What's the penthouse? Like, describe the biggest penthouse you guys made up there.
Yeah, man. I mean, we don't have, you know, because it's such a unique building, we don't really have penthouses like the way you would think of, like,
I
you
see.
Know, the Trump Tower or one of the other tall buildings, right? Where you're, mm-hmm. like the top floors or penthouse. It was so unique because the top floors of this building are like the smallest floor plates.
Mm.
So like the top seven floors are all like one bedroom, 1300 square foot apartments.
Yeah.
That have an elevator that just opens straight into the unit. But they're kind of small, right?
Right.
They're not like the you know, the most expensive or the, sure, you know, but they're highly desirable. But like the, you know, so we call these, like, we have these premier, right? So because they're all over the place, so they're not really penthouse, they're like premier units.
Mm-hmm.
And there's certain ones that have, like, you know, almost 2,000 square feet of outdoor space. Like,
oh, wow.
It's like 4,000 square foot unit with another 2,000 square feet of, of just like outdoor space in the yeah, sky on Michigan Avenue.
That's awesome.
All right, so there's those, and there's like other ones that have like these cool double height windows, 20 foot ceilings, you know, and just,
yeah,
you know, look amazing.
What's the most expensive one there?
Man, I don't know if I can say.
Oh, no, I got you.
I don't know. I don't know if I don't know. Expensive.
Sure. I got you.
multiple millions.
Yeah. But another thing that I wanted to mention, when
you can look it up. I don't know.
Yeah, for sure. I'm sure. No big deal. It's out of my price range. So
yeah, mine too, man.
But when you took us up there, you took us to the old CEOs of the,
yeah, so yeah, the office,
right? The
McCormick's
office.
McCormick's office, like, that's one of the premier units, right? It was his office on the 24th floor. It was like him and Patterson. They were like, I think, brothers or something.
Okay. The guys who started the Tribune newspaper.
The newspaper.
Okay.
Yeah. And yeah, they had their offices up there, so they were still intact when we took over. They weren't used as such for a long time.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
But I remember, like, when we went into the office of the CEO, he had like a little backway getaway tunnel right out of his office.
He had like a little hiding spot where, like, if somebody was bothering him, where he was a little paranoid or something, and he would like take this like secret door that would go up, and it was like above his office. There was like, uh-huh, a room up there. It was like a panic room or something.
And nobody knew.
Yeah,
knew.
Nobody, like, you know, people didn't know about it for a while, and then we were like, you know, kind of exploring around and saw it.
Oh, so you guys didn't even know it was there.
I don't know. I think you know, so the people on the team knew it.
I gotcha.
But
it's funny though, because a dude that owns a newspaper, I'm sure he was a little bit worried too about people coming to get him.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
you know how it is with those guys.
I bet, man. I don't know how it was 100 years, but I'm sure.
Yeah,
I gotta hide somewhere.
Yeah, he's hearing the footsteps.
Yeah.
Coming up the stairs. He's like, dang, I gotta get out of here. Well, that's cool, man. That's an awesome project, man, because it's got such a historic, you know, view to the building.
Yeah.
That, and now you're able to work on that building and change it from what it was to something new.
Yeah.
And like you said, your name's gonna be tied to that building forever.
Yeah, it's really cool. I mean, again, when I was like interviewing for this job, I was like, oh my God, this is amazing.
This is what you signed up
this
for.
This is what I, you know, I've been kind of waiting for my whole life so far, right? You know? And it's cool. You know, you're, you know, we call it, you know, in the marketing material and all that kind of stuff, we keep talking about it as like a once in a lifetime, you know, it's a very unique, place to live,
yeah, right?
for the people that are buying, and that's how we really approached the building. It was a once in a lifetime opportunity for the whole team to,
yeah,
work on something that's so historic, and you know, it's one of the, you know, few buildings you can name on your hand that are associated with Chicago.
Yeah,
you know, and to have the ability to kind of take that building, you know, it's almost approaching the 100 years of when it was originally built.
Uh-huh.
And then to like completely repurpose it and update it and do all these things for the next 100 years.
Yeah.
You know, that's like, it's a building that's never going to be,
yeah,
torn down and never be built again. Like nobody would build a building like that.
The way it was built back then.
The way it was built, yeah, and the way it was designed.
Yeah.
You know, you just, nobody builds that. Like, you would never see that today.
Yeah, that's awesome, man. I feel like going into architecture, it's like these are the projects that you envision yourself doing. It's like these big buildings, these skyscrapers,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
You don't when you go into architecture, you don't think you're gonna be doing student dorms or,
yeah. Well, that's what you dream about. You dream about, you know, building, right, a building that, you know, you can point to.
Exactly, and, like,
you're like, yeah.
I did that,
right? That's what you, that's, I think, anybody's,
yeah,
dream that starts there.
That's awesome, man. So kind of thinking back on everything and tying everything together, would you have done anything different when it comes to school, career choice, where you're at right now, and so on?
I don't know, man. I try to live a life without, like, you know, I feel like if you want to do something different, you're not happy with kind of the way you potentially, you know, the way I associate it.
Right. Right?
It's like, yeah,
you're not happy,
I'm not
with
happy
something.
With something that, you know, and I love the way my life turned out.
Yeah.
You know, what I do, what I'm, you know, not just what I do and what I'm, you know, working on and all that kind of stuff. There's so many connections with people that I've made just by making the choices
that I made.
Right. Like, you know, my wife, I met my wife at Gensler, Chicago. Right. So like if I went to UCLA, I would have never met her.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And it's, you know, that's the kind of stuff that, you know, you, it's kind of hard to disassociate the, oh, I would have done this differently.
Yeah. But then I would, this probably would have happened.
And then what would have all this stuff happened? Right. So I don't know. Like, I don't think, you know, looking back kind of critically, you know, like, did I really need to do masters,
right,
to be where I am today and get licensed? Probably not.
Yeah.
You know, would have been better if I gotten like a master's in something else, like business or something like that,
mm-hmm.
potentially for my career. But, you know, can't go back and change things.
Yeah. I mean, I'm pretty sure things turned out pretty well. So,
yeah, man.
I mean, I'm sure there's no regrets there.
No.
But, you know, with this podcast, I hope people and kids that are wanting to go into architecture can take out some pieces out of this podcast that can hopefully help them out.
Yeah.
But if people did want it, you know, if somebody did want to reach out to you, you know, would they be okay reaching out to you? And if somebody had any, you know, questions on architecture, or if they needed advice on school, or, you know, anything that they might have, would you be okay with people reaching out to you?
Yeah, man. Yeah. I mean, of course, I always, you know, I'd love to, like I said, what you're doing here and kind of the focus of what your podcast is. And one of the reasons I came on, right, is to kind of talk about this stuff and potentially help somebody that, you know, might be thinking about doing something similar.
Right.
Or anything really, right? But they've been inspired or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Awesome. Absolutely. Awesome, man. I appreciate that. Which is, you know, this is why we're doing this, to raise awareness and bring people together. But thank you for coming on. Are you hungry or what?
Yeah, man. I've been waiting to go eat.
What are you trying to grab to eat?
I don't know. We'll see. What, I don't know. Haven't been in Berwyn in a while.
No, we got a few spots we can discuss. But again, man, thank you so much for coming on.
Thanks for having me.
No, it was my pleasure, but you'll be hopefully coming on again, and there's other topics we'll be able to discuss, and hopefully you're a future guest again.
I'll come anytime you'll have me.
Awesome, man. Yeah. And we got to get I got to get a couple more mics so we can get like four people going at once. And
typical Friday night or something.
Yeah, have like a little Catan game going like you mentioned earlier.
Yeah, man. It's a great game.
Everybody, please, if you enjoyed this episode number 3 with Nikola Krčmarević, please leave a comment. Let me know what you thought about the episode. Give me a like if you enjoyed it. Please share it with other people. Again, Nikola, thank you for coming on.
Pleasure.
Peace out, everybody.
Cool. All right, man. Whew. Dude, you were kidding. I'm freezing. You were kidding. I'm cold, bro.
My bad. We'll turn it on right now.